morning, Your Honors. If it pleases the Court, my name is Michael Donahoe. I work for the Federal Defender's Office. I was one of Ms. Graham's trial counsel. And I'm here before the Court with multiple claims, but I've tried to think this through to a logical spot. And I think the center of gravity for me before the Court this morning is the plea withdrawal papers. And I'd like to focus on those. That issue and the acceptance of responsibility issue will be my primary focus. Anything that I don't get to address within the time limitations, please, Your Honors, take the papers that we submitted and consider those arguments.
We always read them. For all counsel, we always read the briefs intensively, so you don't have to worry about waiving any arguments. If you want to waive them up here, that's fine.
No, and that's precisely why I mentioned it here. Thank you.
Not to worry.
Well, can I just jump in and ask you?
Sure.
Sorry, I'll try to talk right into this. Did you have some kind of discussions with whoever the AUSA was? I don't know if it's one of these two gentlemen over here, where they basically led you to believe that they were not only going to dismiss counts 1 and 3, but also recommend a sentence more consistent with a second-degree murder conviction. Is that kind of the...
You know, I have nothing in the record that I could point to in terms of sentencing recommendation. The answer to the question is no.
Okay. That seems to me you were out of luck, because the terms of the agreement, as they were expressed on the record, said that prosecution would dismiss counts 1 and 3, and they did that. So how could there be a breach? I guess that's
okay.
Where I have stuck.
And I appreciate that. That's a nice entry, I think, into the discussion that I need to have. The first thing I want to talk about is this plea withdrawal paper and the consideration that the Court gave that request. We came in prior to the sentencing and asked that the plea be withdrawn. And Judge Malloy, you can look in the ER, I think it's in Volume 1, commencing at about page 22 and running on through 27, 28. And the Court gives due consideration to what it deems the factors for a fair and just reason. It appears from this record reference that all parties were in agreement, including the Court, that the fair and just reason standard did not have anything to do with the voluntariness of the plea. And I want to emphasize that point. Under this Court's decision in Ortega-Asciano, which is cited in Showalter, and we cited Showalter, there's expressed language in that decision that says that if the Court, on a fair and just reason standard, essentially disallows the withdrawal of the plea because the plea was voluntary, that's not appropriate. And that's what the Court did here. The Court listed certain factors like competency of counsel, prejudice to the government having to retry the case, those sorts of reasons.
Well, but what was the fair and just reason? That was asserted. It appears that it was essentially she didn't expect the government to be arguing this, and since they were arguing it, she had a fair and just reason, which is pretty similar to a voluntariness, i.e., I was misled or misunderstood what was going to happen.
Well, I don't know that we need to reach that high of a bar. I think that the way that the...
How would you define what fair and just reason you were arguing for then or are arguing for now?
Well, the fair and just reason was that the claim was to be dropped. The count was to be dropped. Count 1 was to be dropped. Premeditation distinguishes first-degree murder from second-degree murder. The government agreed that premeditation was off the table here.
They agreed to dismiss count 1, and they did that.
And
that's why I started out where I did. If you were saying that they led me to believe that there was something more that I was going to get for my client, I'm all ears, but you're saying there isn't. And that's where it ends.
Well, there's no express recommendation, but I don't know why I would have to have in a plea agreement of this nature at this time, in this context, something expressed that said that the government couldn't argue premeditation at sentencing. Why would I need that?
But you're not arguing that they in fact breached the plea agreement.
Yes, I am. That's part of the argument here.
Then you're...
Oh, all I was going to say is that it seems to me, I was getting slightly interested in the way you were approaching it, which was, I thought, trying to divorce yourself from the argument that they in fact breached the plea agreement, because it appears fairly clear that they did not in fact breach the plea agreement because they didn't make any agreement about sentencing. So I understood that you were trying to say, well, whether or not they breached the plea agreement, there was still that the fair, just reason standard is lower and different, and that it still should have been granted. And that's what I was trying to find out. What is the fair, just reason, assuming they did not, in fact, breach the plea agreement?
And I think that's a good summary, Your Honor, Judge Bergeson, of our position. But I don't want to abandon the fact that I think that there was an agreement here for that count to be dismissed.
It was. And I take your point, counsel, but when it did come to sentencing, Judge Malloy focused on a lot of things. He did not give any that much emphasis to premeditation. He went through a whole host of factors, and you were there. So you know why he was so upset and why he arrived at the sentence he did. So you're saying, well, there was a breach. The judge, and it's hard to say there's a breach because they didn't specifically agree to take premeditation off the table. It's an implicit understanding. I could see maybe how you got there. But if we get to the point that Judge Berzon is making, if we then retreat, if you will, to the fair and just reason, what is the fair and just reason?
Well, Your Honor, I think that again, that's a good summary, but we're talking here about a matter of degree. We're coming from breach all the way down, maybe to fair and just reason if it's a lesser standard, and I think we understand it that way. If that's the case, then I think the overall context of how this plea was realized, the actual context in which it arose, is very, very important. We had a jury waiting in the jury room. We made an agreement that was supposed to resolve this premeditation issue. It was the major contention in the case.
But if you'd gone ahead, if she'd gone ahead and gone to the jury and they found her guilty of murder one, she would have been facing life imprisonment mandatory, right?
I understand.
And for the taking one off the table for the jury, you got the benefit of that bargain. And that's what it appears objectively on the record as the quid pro quo. And then you're saying, well, the government then shouldn't have made the argument that all of the things that she did to commit this murder should be taken into account in sentencing. Danger to the community, all the factors that the judge is going to be considering. And you're saying that the government wasn't supposed to be able to argue any of those things. And maybe it's not an open and shut case, but I have to say that that's asking a lot. Absent an explicit statement as we find in other cases. Promise we won't argue, we won't pursue a higher sentence and so on. So that's what I'm trying to hear from you.
Well, Your Honor, and what I'm trying to say is that I respectfully think it's unfair to indicate all of the advantage that the defendant might realize and not look at all the disadvantage that the government was getting out of, so to speak, by offering the plea. You have to remember that in the context of taking the plea, Judge Malloy went through all of the factors, things like the keys, the cell phone. He did all of those things, the inane texting, and there were explanations offered by Ms. Graham for each and every one of those things. And the government comes in, doesn't say anything at the plea withdrawal hearing, or at the plea hearing.
No plea, and a conviction for second-degree murder, and an acquittal on first degree. The government could have done exactly what it did. I mean, that is, in my view, somewhat crazy law, but that's the law, right?
But they had to risk a manslaughter verdict.
Right.
And they didn't have...
After the fact, had there been a second-degree murder conviction, an acquittal at first degree, they could have gone and argued exactly as they did on premeditation, right?
Well, and that's a hypothetical. That's exactly
what... hypothetical, that's why...
All I'm saying, Your Honor, is that each party, Your Honors, that each party laid down its arms with respect to this premeditation issue, and it was profoundly unfair for the government to have the advantage of coming in and re-arguing it on the very points.
I will give you a minute of rebuttal. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good morning. May it please the Court. Zeno Baucus on behalf of the United States. Along with Mr. McLean, I was trial counsel on this matter, and I can assure you I did not have direct conversations with Mr. Dono as to the nature of the plea, but I was present for them. And there was no agreement as to sentencing recommendations as part of the plea agreement.
But can I? I was just going to say, it seems to me that you violated the spirit, if not the letter, of the agreement. Because I understand why defense counsel is so upset about this. It seems to me, especially as he said, given the context in which this plea was arrived at, as I understand it, it was initiated or reinitiated by you guys, right? On the eve of letting the case go to the jury, it seems to me, if I were in defense counsel's shoes, I would understand the government's sort of reaching out an olive branch, so to speak, to say, we'll go with second degree. You'll give up the possibility of getting a manslaughter conviction. We'll give up the possibility of getting a first degree murder conviction. We'll dismiss the count one. And I think implicit in that is that we'll make a sentencing recommendation consistent with a second degree murder conviction, and that's not what you did.
I disagree respectfully, Your Honor. I don't think there's any implicit agreement and understanding as to what we would or not recommend at sentencing. We entered in this agreement to give the district court, which had heard all the evidence to that point, discretion in terms of sentencing the defendant. Obviously something that a first-degree murder conviction would not do. I don't think there's anything in the record or in the law that would bind the hands of the United States in terms of arguing the facts of the case as they saw fit.
What sentence were you in fact arguing for at that point?
Your Honor, we argued for no less than 600 months at sentencing. And as the district court pointed out at the Rule 11 hearing, the district court advised the defendant, and she understood, the United States could argue for an upward variance at sentencing. She acknowledged that. The district court also advised the defendants, the defense counsel, had argued.
I don't think the judge said anything about what the government could recommend. I don't have every word memorized, but I thought he was just saying, I, as the judge, could still give you life. Is there some specific representation that the government was in a position to?
Not what the government would recommend, but the government had the right to ask for an upward variance at sentencing. That is in the record of the change of plea, Your Honor. And in addition to other back and forth of the Rule 11 hearing, district court advised the defendant no less than six times you could receive up to life in prison as a result of this guilty plea. District court advised the defendant that if you don't get life in prison, you may receive a guideline range sentence and then supervised release.
But what the judge could or couldn't do, in my mind, is irrelevant to the question before us, because what she's saying is that I extracted from you, the government, a promise to make some kind of an argument at sentencing. So it's always true that the judge can, of course, ignore whatever you recommend and throw the book at the person. But if a part of the benefit of her bargain, at least in the defense counsel's understanding, was that you, as the government, were going to recommend a sentence more consistent with second than first-degree murder, then it seems to me that's most definitely not what happened, because a 600-month sentencing recommendation is not consistent with what you typically see in a second-degree murder.
I understand, but that was not the benefit of her bargain. Her benefit of her bargain was to avoid mandatory life in prison, which a first-degree murder conviction would have resulted in. That was it. And there was no other agreement.
That's what they said.
I'm sorry, Your Honor.
That's what was said.
No, Your Honor. The only agreement was called for us to dismiss the first degree and making false statements.
She said the reason we're doing this is to avoid mandatory life.
Your Honor, I think that's the benefit of the bargain in terms of...
That's implicit in what...
That's implicit.
Okay, so on his side, he's saying it's implicit that when you're giving up first degree, you won't turn around and argue that the second degree murder is essentially all has all the elements of first degree murder in it, so therefore you should sentence accordingly.
I understand that's his argument, but again, I don't think there's any basis.
You don't think that's implicit?
I do not, Your Honor. We are dismissing count one. That carries a first degree mandatory conviction.
It is really a little more refined than that, because he didn't have to exactly prove that there was a violation of the plea agreement, and he didn't have to exactly prove that there was not a voluntary plea, that there was a misunderstanding. He had to prove that there was a fair and just reason. Articulation of what that reason might be if it's none of those. It seemed to me it could be something like, well, we understand that there was no express promise made, but it was our understanding that there was an implicit promise, or at least that this wouldn't happen, and without saying it's involuntary, the defendant would not have pled guilty if she had known this was going to happen, and that's a fair and just reason. Why isn't it?
It's not a fair and just reason, Your Honor, because there's no law to support that argument.
Well, but the law on fair and just reasons is a little flimsy, a little vague. What do you think the law is? I guess is what I'm asking.
I think the law against it is there are factors under 11D for a fair and just reason. I understand, I agree with the court that it can be vague, but we go down a very slippery slope if we start essentially implying rights, implying sentencing recommendations, when it is not in the record in the context.
The plea agreement happened very fast with a bit of a gun to everybody's head in terms of the jury's out there. It has to be done now or never. There was some suggestion that in the record that I don't understand about that it came from other higher ups or other sources. I don't know what that meant. Do you know what that was about?
My understanding, Your Honor, is that my superior and Mr. Dondo's superior had a discussion. And it filtered down the line as to the line AUSA and Mr. Donahoe at the actual trial.
So this wasn't talked out in the ordinary sense. It was just kind of from somewhat precipitously decided at a time when it needed to be decided, or else it was going to the jury, and not with the direct involvement, I gather, of the people on the ground. So why isn't it simply a fair and just reason that done this had we known what was going to happen, and we didn't really have time to think about it and negotiate it out in the ordinary sense. None of this was quite said, but it seems to me that that's what's underlying this. And she shouldn't be have to go through with the plea agreement under these circumstances. So I need a legal reason why that's not a fair and just reason.
I think the legal reason, Your Honor, is because the parties were operating under the Rule 11 case law and the sentencing case law as they understood it. United States versus Ensinger, the defendant can plead guilty, receive the sentencing papers, receive the government's recommendation on the sentencing, but that is not a fair and just reason to withdraw his or her plea. I think that the same principles is in play here. There is nothing else besides the government's agreement to dismiss counts 1 and 3 at sentencing. We did that. There is no understanding that we could not argue certain factors at sentencing. To say that we should have jumped up at the Rule 11 hearing and say, no, we're allowed to argue certain facts when it comes to sentencing, I think creates a very dangerous precedent for purposes of Rule 11 hearings going forward.
I've been trying with both sides and not getting an answer. What standard applies to the fair and just reason?
I think, as the court noted, it is a vague concept. There are factors the court looks at.
What factors are applicable or not applicable?
Everything from the competency of counsel to intervening events to the adequacy of a Rule 11 hearing to changes in law. The counsel cited a decision, I think it's the Ortega decision, if I heard correctly. In that case, I believe there was a Supreme Court precedent on point between the defendant's change of plea and the sentencing. Certainly nothing involved the facts of this case. So again, I think the district court correctly articulated the issue at the beginning of the sentencing hearing in Volume 1. defendant's argument is nothing more than a sentencing argument. They didn't like what we were recommending in terms of sentencing, but the defendant was arguing for a downward variance, we were arguing for an upward variance, and that was perfectly appropriate under the law and the record in this case. If there are any other questions, I'm happy to answer.
One other question. Is there any law that would say when you as the government, at the change of plea hearing, you take the factual basis that the defendant offers for the crime, that, I don't know, that you're sort of buying that as the purchaser of the plea agreement? In other words, you are the one who stands up and says to the judge, here's the factual basis, this is what the government would prove. This is so unusual because the case had been proved. And so the judge very much wanted to hear from the defendant herself. But when you sit there and you don't pipe up and say, well, no, Your Honor, if she's trying to say this was just merely a reckless act, we beg to differ. You don't have any obligation to, if you know you're going to argue a sentencing for a sentence that's consistent more with a premeditated murder, you don't have any obligation to at least acknowledge on the record, we don't accept that as the factual basis for the plea.
Your Honor, I don't believe we do. And as the court alluded to, the proof was in the trial record. All the parties, including the district court, acknowledged it for purposes of a Rule 11 factual basis. The proof was in the trial record. That's at ER 12 and ER 1837. As for any case law or any points that the United States has to stand up during the allocution of the defendant, I could not find any because, frankly, I don't think it exists. The case law the defendant advanced in his brief, the Cooper holding and the Hawley holding out of the Tenth Circuit, in those decisions, the government made affirmative representations in plea agreements as to sentencing, not the case here. If there's anything else, I'll save the rest of my time. Thank you.
I just want to emphasize the...
One quick question. What is the standard of our standard of review of the district court's determination on the fair and just reason?
Abuse of discretion. I think it is. But I want to emphasize this Ortega-Asciano feature. It's factually dissimilar. I'll concede that point. But if you read the law in the case, there's an express statement by this court where it says precisely... that on the fair and just reason standard, if the focus of the court is that the plea was voluntary, that is incorrect. If you look at the record here in ER 2, I think 22 to 27, you will see that Judge Malloy precisely says exactly that. He says, in the cases where the motion to withdraw the plea has been granted, what I'm seeing is the plea was not voluntary. That is in direct contradiction to Ortega-Asciano, the law in Ortega-Asciano.
Rule 11 colloquy part, what are the factors?
It seems to say no under the fair and just reason standard. There is that dissimilarity, and I just want to emphasize that point as a matter of
record. Take a stab at telling me what the fair and just reason is.
The fair and just reason is that the parties were agreeing to lay their arms down here. We had this black cloth situation throughout the period. The government had just come off of that, suffered somewhat of a defeat in that respect. Maybe things look good for us, maybe things look good for them. This was a compromise, and it was indicated in that compromise that the government wouldn't come in and argue all of these very same factors. That sentencing paper is their closing argument.
That reason essentially.
I still think that there's an error of law in the standard that Judge Malloy applied, and at a minimum, we should go back to Judge Malloy and have him reevaluate this fair and just reason based on a more focused look.
I mean, the other thing is that he didn't, as was observed, Judge Malloy didn't seem to rely on any of this anyway.
I'm sorry, ma'am?
Judge Malloy did not seem in a sentence to rely on anything the government said.
I think it's hard to tease that out, especially with respect to the acceptance of responsibility. We wound up.
I don't mean in general. I mean the premeditation. He was most concerned about. It's related to the acceptance of responsibility, but the fact that she lied and misled people and so on for so long, and he didn't say anything that suggested that he was thinking of basing it on premeditation.
On that point, though, I just respectfully would try and segregate that post-event behavior under Silverman. The this court's Silverman decision, which is a very cogent, applicable decision. Post-event behavior of this nature can attach to any degree on this continuum, from accidental killing to first-degree murder.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you.